to Fort Fritz, your one stop for news, current events, and all forms of entertainment relating to the paranormal, the supernatural, the Fortean, and things that go bump in the night, all packaged and presented in the form of know-nothing know-it-alls entertaining the unknown. Hello, I am Fritz, joined as always by co-host Mandaddy.
Hi.
And Angela.
Hello.
Kaz has the night off.
We love you, Kazzy.
We love you, baby.
Miss you, Kaz.
So let's get right into it. What do you know about stars blowing up?
Happens all the time. It's happening right now somewhere.
Oh, yeah? Prove it.
Let's go outside and look.
Thank you.
Space.
Angela?
Space.
Space.
Telescopes. We can see them.
Right?
Yeah. It is happening constantly. Yeah. You can even look at a star and it probably already has happened.
Yep.
Billions of years ago. We just haven't. It hasn't reached just yet to show us that it has exploded.
When you're holding hands with your best girl and you're looking up at the stars, those stars are probably dead.
They're dead.
That's what's cool about
all of them are dead.
Supernovas, right? That's what's also cool about looking in a telescope through space. You are looking back in time.
Yeah.
And this is a really fun thing to think about. Light has a speed. So when we look through a telescope, we are looking at that star or that sun's light speeding back to Earth. Einstein, what was
there's a theory about it.
There's a theory of relativity. But everything is relative to how you are looking at a certain situation. TrueStrange.com. Are we bipeds due to a supernova? From the article, an interesting paper in the Journal of Geology claims that supernova bombarded the Earth with energy, peaking 2.6 million years ago. This, they say, created a huge surge in lightning strikes and resulting global fires, turning forests into grasslands.
Ooh.
Okay.
Who was it? Carl Sagan. His quote was, we are meat sacks of interstellar stardust. The nitrogen in our DNA, the calcium in our teeth, the iron in our blood, the carbon in our apple pies were made in the interiors of collapsing suns. We are made of star stuff. How cool is that, right?
It is.
Such a cool, like, almost freeing quote. So this article deals with, are we then bipeds and other animals on Earth because of supernova? Specifically, lions and tigers and bears.
Oh, my.
So they believe our ancient ancestors learned to walk upright to adapt to the new environment. What that environment might have entailed, I don't know, maybe all of the elements falling to Earth and just kind of making a hubbub of everything. But yeah, if a star has exploded and then it reached our Earth, that might mean that we then had a different chemical makeup in our environment. That might mean that some species were trying to fight for a certain, crop or food source. A paper published in the Journal of Geology makes the case supernova bombarded Earth with cosmic energy starting as many as 8 million years ago, initiating an avalanche of electrons in the lower atmosphere and setting off a chain of events that feasibly ended with bipedal hominins such as Homo habilis, dubbed handyman. So if all of these electrons bombarded the lower hemisphere of Earth, where's the Fertile Crescent?
That's in the Iraq area.
Yeah, Mesopotamia. But Israel, why Israel is such a sought-after piece of land is that they have the oldest known DNA that's migrated out of Africa.
Ah, okay.
So that would kind of lend credence to this.
Sure.
So I think that's really fascinating.
It is fascinating.
So maybe because a star blew up, we have people who walk upright. If vampires drink people's bloods...
You got to signal before you turn.
That got me thinking.
always something to think about.
So if, you know, we have folklores, you know, and right here at Fort Fritz, what do? We always want to entertain you, but at the same time, we always want to let you know if there is any kind of factoid in the folklores you've heard for millennia. The vampire folklore fits into this to a T, and I will explain.
Okay.
Two brain rejuvenating proteins have been identified in young blood. So that means that if the supernova exploded and gave us this ability to walk upright, it might have also given rise to an organism not unlike humans that early on tried to correct itself in that as they age, the blood is actually fixing anything that is wrong with the body nerve-wise. So this is from newsscientist.com. And I know that. I know that sounds fake.
Okay, all right.
I love your sources. They're my favorite.
I know that sounds fake. This is by Ruby Prosser Scully. The brain-boosting ingredients of young blood could be two proteins that they've recently found. The proteins help rejuvenate important structures in neurons and may be responsible for why young blood seems to improve cognitive performance in older brains. So we know vampires, you know, like what's another blood story in horror? What's Lady Bathory?
Yeah. Right? Countess Bathory.
Countess Bathory, who took the blood and took a bath in her subject's blood. But they found two proteins, actually, that might reduce the risk of cancer, heart disease, and Alzheimer's. And it all goes back to young blood.
But that doesn't explain why it's so delicious. What is the... I mean, it's just...
No.
It's a,
No, that would... No, it wouldn't, no. Wouldn't explain that.
Well, because, you know, wine you like to age, but some stuff you like to get fresh. Like sushi.
Like the new Slipknot track.
And blood.
Are you down?
And blood. The new Slipknot track?
Yeah.
Yeah, I love it.
Did you get to see... They did a live stream of a whole concert this week, and I missed it. I hope you can still find it somewhere.
I love everything about Slipknot. These two proteins have now been linked to boosting cognition in older animals. So what they did, they took mice, right?
Because, always with the mice.
Because who cares about mice?
I do. Feel bad
for mice.
Mice
are actually making experiments on us, in case you haven't read Hitchhiker's Guide. That we are the experiment, that mice are actually experimenting on us. So,
good on them.
Yeah.
They took 2-week-old mice and they took their blood and then they separately transferred that to mice who were over 1 year old. And they found that the blood serum from the young mice profoundly affected the neuron growth in the brains of older mice. And that would also explain why when people have blood transfusions in hospitals, they will come to and they say they're in the prime of their life. Although, you know, maybe they have a leg removed or a skin graft or whatever. They say, my mind is firing on all cylinders kind of thing. So that might give some kind of theory to the fountain of youth being in young blood. And it would also make sense if over time, evolutionary wise, the human body came up with a way, not unlike alligators who have that kind of like bacterium in their blood that like they can never get sick, right? Have you heard those like reports?
Yeah.
If an alligator gets punctured, it doesn't get sepsis. It doesn't get any kind of infection. Being in a brackish environment with all kinds
with
of microbes.
Whatever, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Larva and just
amoeba.
You know, vector just waiting to enter. They never get sick. So over time, evolutionary-wise, alligators and crocodiles have built up that resistance to microbes that are in their, you know, environment. Well, there are now revealed two new proteins that previously weren't known to be involved in the brain-boosting effects of young blood. And now that they've isolated that, they know that that can actually make an old brain feel younger again.
So basically, they just need to only ever get blood from children.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's, we should have corrals of them.
Yeah.
Almost like Skyrim, really.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
But, I mean, here's the thing. Is when you're thinking about the concept, it's like, does young blood transfusions actually help? Yeah, it's called Keith Richards, okay?
Keith Richards
exists because of this theory. He is proving it in real time on a daily basis.
Only give me blood from a 7-year-old.
Yeah, he always has a corral of them with him. It's amazing.
Keith, how'd you think you'd do tonight? No, it was wise of it.
Because everyone knows what Keith Richards...
Oh, no, Keith. No.
No, Keith. Stay away, Keith.
No, Keith.
Don't let Keith Richards around your kids, especially if he has a straw. There was an interview I saw with Keith Richards being interviewed by Hunter S. Thompson.
Oh, my God.
So two people
could
not understand a thing, and this is how it sounded. This is exactly how it sounded. So, what do you from Manchester? How that's it for 45 minutes. They had a great time.
I would expect nothing less.
Yeah, but it was just fascinating. Watching, it was like, how do they understand what's going on? Is there some sort of mental thing going on? Are they reading runes?
Yeah, probably
reading runes.
Reading the runes.
It does kind of remind me. It's not necessarily on the same thing, but when people get organ transplants, how they'll sometimes acquire certain skills that the person with that organ had. like musicality, yep. playing an instrument, singing mm-hmm. something.
It's that oh. is absolutely fascinating.
And there's tragic sides too. There is a person that got a heart from a person that killed themselves, and like 2 or 3 years later, killed themselves in the exact same way.
Oh, that is very
like,
sad.
And also married a similar woman. Or like a woman had the same similar qualities. It was just this weird thing. It's a there's a whole thread you can read about it, and just that sometimes that your DNA carries information in smaller areas than you'd imagine. You'd think you have to get like the whole your brain or something. It's like no, you can just get a toe, and all of a sudden you got stuff going on.
On thegoogle.com.
What's that?
Many articles pop up: memory transference in organ transplant recipients. Also, 10 organ recipients who took on the traits of their donors, yeah. and that's another fringe. Paranormal, supernatural, like element to science, which is just fascinating. Anyway, that
yes.
we take one person's organ and put it into someone else, give them drugs or like antibody rejection meds that still might give them a higher chance for cancer and yet might still improve their quality of life outside of being dead. Like that is
that
insane.
Is the highest quality of life outside of being dead.
It is absolutely insane. So I segue the young blood. Might have two proteins that are now known to scientists, and they are going to continue research on that. I now take it on a really dark note.
Ooh.
So in Canada, you might not know about this, but Canada was also the site for a massive Ireland emigrant with an E population. So when the potato famine, mm-hmm. the potato blight happened around the 1840s, late 1840s, people from Ireland went westward, and some landed in the United States, some landed in Canada. This was just a few days ago, actually, on Monday. The Canadian government has confirmed that a collection of human remains has been washed up on a beach belonging to victims of a ship that sunk with a boatload of people fleeing the ravages of the Irish famine.
Oh, no.
So they have skeletal remains of the Carrix, C-A-R-R-I-C-K-S shipwreck. Because of the potato blight, the Irish diaspora set up shop all over the, quote, New World, unquote. But these people starved to death, and they were very malnourished. One quote is, whatever you eat shows up in your bones. But I would love to show you this haunting famine memorial in Dublin. These are statues in Dublin of the Irish famine.
Oh, yeah, that's rough.
Yeah, that's rough. That's
really
it's
life-size gaunt figures holding their babies with skeletal hands. There is a dog scrounging for food in the background.
I didn't even notice the dog.
Yeah, it's...
I don't want to see the sad dog.
That's right. Angela's right there.
No.
Can you see it? Angela, can you see it?
Oh, I see it.
After this, we're going to watch Angela watch a dog's life over and over.
What's amazing about this is that 87 bodies were recovered from the shipwreck in 1847, and only 48 people survived the accident, but 48 people made it.
Wow.
It was in 2011 when the bones of three children washed up on a beach at Cap de Rosier, following a storm, and in 2016, archaeologists excavated the remains of 18 others, mostly women and children. Over time, through DNA testing, they determined that these bones were ancient. I can only imagine the decompositional makeup of them, like being in a saline solution for that long. They know now that it was from the exact same carbon footprint as the Carrix shipwreck in 1847.
Wow.
So that's, again, science just proving things right. What have we learned today?
Let's look back.
Science has said because of a star blowing up, we are probably walking upright. Probably because of the same evolutionary traits that made us walk upright. We have two proteins, heretofore unknown, and might boost cognitive function in older brains. And also, nothing has changed. People are still trying to escape oppression and try to live their best lives. And Canada has said this is a fact, that people will still, no matter what the circumstance, will try to make sure that evolutionary-wise, they prosper. And on that note, let's take a little break. You're listening to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1. Androgynous, closer than you know.
The love we chose to sow and ordain us.
4.1 Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1.
Welcome back to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1. I am Man Daddy. Right over there, we got Angela.
What's up?
And, of course, our mighty host, Fritz.
Yellow. You know, we are an iHeart radio station. What does that mean? You might be asking, what does that mean?
What does it mean?
What does it mean?
It makes no sense to me. Those are just words.
Well, I'll tell you. You can download that app. It's absolutely free from your app store and the little computer resting in your pocket. Hopefully, if you're driving, or in your hand right now at the bar, talking with friends. It's the iHeartRadio app. Just download it and search Fort Fritz, F-O-R-T-F-R-I-T-Z. Angela, you've seen a Netflix something or other. It's called I Am Mother.
Yes.
Is it a movie?
It is a movie. It's a movie. Well, then tell us,
Dime.
Yes. It just released on Friday, actually, on Netflix. It is called I Am Mother, and it is based in the future. It's one of those dystopian movies.
All things in the future are dystopian now.
Yeah,
why? Mean, why?
Like
is
in
that?
The 50s I and think, 60s, there is hope.
Yeah, no, everyone's like, we're going to kill the planet because humans suck, and this is just our take on what's going to happen. So it incorporates AI, artificial intelligence, and robots. And it kind of is based upon, like, a declaration of human extinction. And you start off with this robot and they're raising babies, but with like
robots
like,
can't raise babies.
But this one can, and it is called Mother, which is a very creative name for it.
Yeah, they really worked all night on that one.
You know, they don't really go into the backstory of where all these embryos come from, but they have them all frozen in all these machines, and you're just watching this one robot in this whole pod, I would say, where they live, and is just this robot and this one baby that is quote unquote born the robot. And I'm assuming it's all in America because everything's all in English.
Mm-hmm.
And
leave it to America to come up with a nightmarish robot situation where they're now better mothers than humans.
And you're watching this robot, and it's voiced by Rose Byrne, who is an Australian actress.
Okay.
She was in Bridesmaids. She has a really nice voice, actually, because it's just voiceover work, because she is the voice of the robot.
I mean, she's a total babe.
She's
I'm
a total babe.
I'm showing the picture
she's
to
gorgeous.
Man Daddy.
There you go.
And she has been in so many American movies that I did not realize she was Australian.
Sure.
Every
no
other country can do a better American accent than any American can do any other country's accent.
Yeah.
They just come over here and just think, like, oh. Like, when people find out that what's his name, from Walking Dead, they find out that he was English.
It
was like,
Andrew Lincoln?
Yeah, Andrew Lincoln. It's like, when you hear him talk regularly, it's like, what?
I actually didn't know Christian Bale was British for a long time.
Oh, yeah, a lot of people didn't know
that. I did not know that. Also,
until you heard that with him freaking out at his crew, that was... Well, there's that. Thank you!
During Terminator Salvation.
I'm sure it was like an MTV Movie Awards when he won something for Batman that he went up there and I was like, wait, what? What?
Hold up!
Yeah, also, he says quarter instead of quarter.
Quarter.
You're like,
quarter.
What the hell?
Also, Hugh Laurie from House.
So this is a movie. So this, again, is I Am Mother on Netflix.
Yes.
And it's a movie about a robot that gives birth to a human embryo.
No,
no, it just
does
takes
not
care of him,
give
right?
birth. So
that would be cool.
You're watching. It'd be really weird. They do have this like whole incubation. They do have a whole incubation, obviously. So it's like putting this like globe that the baby is in and growing. So they're trying to replicate the natural birthing process as much as possible, but using technology and machines. And it's one robot raising this one baby. And they kind of do like a quick montage in the beginning of like, oh, it's a baby.
Montage.
They're taking care of it. And the way she's talking to it and kind of using like motherly tones and, oh, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. And so the voice and everything about the reaction to the baby sounds very natural and very human, but it's not. And then like, it looks almost like they're trying to raise like a superhuman, kind of like give them all the good education. And what I really liked about this one particular character, obviously, is that they made her a dancer. So the one, like the girl who was being raised, like she was a beautiful dancer. And that actress, her name was like Clara.
Claire Ruggard?
Yes.
Boom.
R-U-G-A-A-R-D.
Never seen her in anything before. Oh, she's a babe too. She's super, super cute. Yeah, oh, yeah, she's beautiful.
Total babe.
And it's just her talking to this, which was really impressive if you think about it acting-wise. Like, there's just one actor talking to a CGI robot this whole time. It was mostly her kind of carrying this whole movie by herself.
I know a lot of actors who don't like to do that.
They don't. Actually, Sir Ian McKellen, he had a whole meltdown during Lord of the Rings because he was Gandalf. And he's like, I got into acting so I could actually talk with other people. Now I'm talking to this green screen and these green images. And he like
and a tennis ball and a stick.
Yeah. Like, it really, he had a really hard time with that. Kit Harington said as well. For Game of Thrones, too. He had a really hard time.
That's why I wouldn't pet that goddamn dog.
And that's why I wouldn't pet it.
Direwolf. It's the same thing.
Pet the direwolf. Make the CGI fur look like it's being petted.
Never.
And so you're watching this whole thing, but it never was really explaining why, what happened. And there was like this one particular part where she's in class. By herself, and mother's obviously her teacher because it's literally the two of them existing in this pod. Not really a pod because it's like a
underground facility
of some sort.
So this is the daughter?
Yeah, daughter. So they're literally, they don't have names. It's mother and daughter. So the robot's name is mother and the girl's name is daughter.
Clara Ruggard.
Yes.
And the mother is
Rose.
The voice of Rose Byrne.
Yes.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Which is the robot.
And
this is really interesting to me because it's like
interesting.
It's like a good. It seems like a good sci-fi movie.
It is. And everything about it seems really nice at the beginning. They seem to have this nice rapport. Mother seems really loving and caring. But also good, like disciplinary. Like there, you kind of get the idea that they're trying to create a specific. Breed of humans because they are saying that they've extinct and there was some virus out there that killed everybody and that they're trying to save her. One of the exercises was you have five people and you're a doctor and
I'm a doctor.
And
no, you're not. We've been telling you this for years. You're not a doctor.
She
Fritz.
Just told me I was.
She's not talking to you.
Four people who need organs donated and one person comes in and they're really sick.
Easy peasy.
And you know how to fix that sick person. But there's some timing issue with it. But that sick person actually is a perfect donor for all four of these people. Do you save that person or do you let that person die and you donate their organs to the four other people? Like, what's that choice? And so that's what the class is. So you're not really getting like math. I mean, I'm sure there was like math and reading and everything else, but that's part of her curriculum of learning.
That probably goes back to the Hippocratic oath of do only good, no harm. But for me as a crooked doctor, because you just said I was a doctor, yeah. I'd be like, yeah, let's kill that mother. Just send all the organs elsewhere.
This is why everyone needs to stay away from Fort Fritz Health Clinic. Stay away from okay. Fort Fritz yeah, Health Clinic.
It's not our strength.
That's a new sponsor.
It's not what we're known for.
I don't even know why we opened the place in the first place. It was because you told me as a doctor.
It was a new...
I mean, always want to challenge yourself.
Thank you.
See what you can do. You don't know what you're good at.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Your reach should always exceed your grasp.
Yeah, exactly. and everything seems like normal, and you're kind of figuring out what's going on, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, someone is banging on the door. And it's Hillary Swank. As Hillary Swank.
That would be disturbing in itself. Like, what's going on? It's Hillary Swank! She's the only one left!
And she shows up, and of course, daughter... being the good person that she is, because she's been kind of molded to be, but also just naturally was a good person, lets her in. Mother has a big problem with that. And then all of a sudden you're seeing this, like, you're like, oh, I bet a lot of people can like relate to this. Like, mother kind of has like a borderline personality disorder a little bit because she's this robot because she's trying to protect this person, but also creating them for this greater good of something.
Creating a bigger problem.
Yeah. And then you find out, oh, there were two other people before daughter. What happened to those people? And you don't really find out what happened to the first one because daughter's number three of this whole experiment. You don't really know what happened to the first person, but you do find out what happened to the second person, which I'm not going to say because I don't want to spoil it.
Right.
So then everything starts to feel a little more sinister. And then,
I love the word sinister.
Left-handed.
Hilary Swank's character, you're not really sure about her whole deal either, because she was shot, but you're not sure by whom. And then, so you can kind of see Hilary Swank's character, who is just known as Woman. They also don't give her a name. So there's Mother, Daughter, and Woman.
And again, this movie is called what?
I Am Mother.
I Am Mother, and it's on Netflix?
On Netflix. And so the whole time you're watching Daughter try to figure out, do I listen to Mother? Because now Mother doesn't seem right. Mm-hmm. I feel like I've been lied to about all these like things going on in my life. But what about this random woman that just came in, but she was shot? What was she doing? What's going on with her? It was really fascinating. It was really good. And I kind of don't want to say the rest because...
Yeah, that's the thing. There's so many movies that I want to review, like the one I'm going to be doing tonight, where you just can't really talk too much about it because it just ruins the experience.
I feel like everything I review on this show, I can't actually talk about.
Yeah.
It's really hard.
That's what sucks about, like, and Jack, if you're listening, Jack Bradshaw, of the show, Boss Man Jack, if you
Hi,
are,
Jack.
We appreciate being on Rural Radio 104.1, a heritage station right here in Central Florida, but what are you doing, man? It's like, we can't talk about anything.
You can't talk about anything, man.
So out of seven Angela replicants, how would you rate I Am Mother on Netflix?
I would give it I feel like I always give everything this. I'm going to say a 6.75.
A 6.75. So that's almost must watch.
Yeah.
Seven is like must watch.
I just really, I don't know. I really liked it and I thought it was done well. Visually, it was beautiful. There were certain aspects of it that kind of reminded me of like certain scenes, like at the end when things kind of really go down, like of Alien. Like, you're watching Ripley, like, walking through,
Ripley,
like, the...
Sigourney
Weaver. Okay, so that's more of a suspense. Suspense.
It becomes a thriller, because things get really intense at the end. So it does become a thriller. It gets kind of intense.
Because I didn't see that from what you were talking about before.
Right, so...
It seemed more like a think piece.
Which is, it's a little bit of that, but it's a little bit of an action piece towards the end, so...
What I'm kind of picking up from it is not unlike Children of Men.
A little bit of Children of Men. Well, that was more like people couldn't have kids anymore.
And men dominated, men centric.
That sounds like a good movie right here. I liking that
this
movie.
This is more like the humans suck at being humans. Let's try to create better humans. So the robots think that they can create better human. But it was, I liked it. It was a think piece, but it was a little bit of a sci-fi thriller as well, thrown in there. And I thought it was acted well, visually very cool. I was really impressed with Clara, who played Daughter. She was great. I definitely recommend it. 6.75.
Nice.
So 6.75 of 7 from Angela. I Am Mother is currently sitting at a 90% critics census on Rotten Tomatoes.
Really?
Outside of the 90% critics rating, it has a higher rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Angela, thank you so much for that.
It was great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Loved it. Check it out. Netflix. I Am Mother.
It sounds so...
It was good.
It sounds so heavy and hard.
It was.
All female cast.
All female cast, actually.
Was this new Ghostbusters? Come on.
Yeah. Which I also noticed as I was watching it.
It's about damn time.
Yeah, it was great.
There is such a tide changing that when it comes to it, it is such a trip to watch, and knowing that there's certain people out there who just can't stand it.
Yep. Good.
Rollins College Radio. Almost every song I hear on there is a female centric band now.
Nice.
It's a massive sea change since like the past 5 years I've been listening.
It's crazy. There's so much more representation, so much more diversity, so many more people of color, so many women getting and LGBT and everything just getting their due, at least on screen. Maybe not in society, but more on screen.
It is so true. And it is something that, you know, growing up as a woman, and you're watching all these like men in these high positions, it really does in your head make you think that men get those positions, not women. It is ingrained in your brain when you're only seeing men in these certain positions and saying certain things and the success and everything like that. It kind of makes you feel like, oh, I can't.
Yeah.
Thank you for saying that.
But it's true, because I remember feeling like that way as a kid.
As men, we can't imagine that.
No, a big thing. You know? Yeah, that's like what you just said is a big, like, heavyweight.
People mention representation, you know, and even when you're talking about race and stuff, it's a big deal because it really, like, pop culture wise, politically, everything, what you're seeing if it's not something that you feel like represents you, you feel like that's it's someone else that gets to do that and not someone like you.
Right. It doesn't. I had a friend who just talked about how much their daughter flipped out by seeing Captain Marvel.
Oh, yeah.
Just by seeing a female-led superhero movie and how much it changed her, his little girl. And I'm like, you know, I'm a white dude. You know, as a white dude, all this is just like, what do you mean? Everything's great. You know, and there's so many people that talk to online that are like white dudes talking about it. It's like, you don't get it. You don't understand what's going on.
Right. And it's just what you've been brought up and thinking. And I've had lots of wonderful, supportive male friends say, like, you can totally do that. It's like, you have no idea. You've always been made to feel like you can do that. I haven't.
So this movie, I Am Mother, on Netflix, shook that core out of you to say, like, yeah, man, this is that kind of movie.
It was definitely neat to just see that all the main characters were women, but that wasn't made a big deal that they were all women. They just happened to be female leads in this movie.
Angela, thank you very much. Coming up, Man Daddy, you have The Perfection.
The Perfection. Another Netflix-y. All about the Netflix-y.
Always. Coming up, Man Daddy is going to tell us all about The Perfection. You're listening to Fort Fritz right here on Real Radio 104.1.
Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1.
Welcome back to Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1. I'm Angela, joined by Fritz.
Hello.
And Man Daddy.
Hi.
And thank you guys for listening. You can find us on Facebook at Fort Fritz, on Instagram at Fort Fritz, and Twitter at Fort Fritz MCT. And Man Daddy.
Yes.
You watched a movie on Netflix, did you?
Yes, I did. We seem to be liking the Netflix this week. We had a whole HBO episode last week. This is now all about Netflix. I saw a movie called The Perfection.
Ooh.
Oh, I saw the trailer for that.
Yeah, the trailer's pretty intense.
Yeah.
It was. I enjoyed it. It was fun. Like everything, it's got issues. It's not the perfection isn't perfect. Shocker. And I always talk, always bring up willing suspension of disbelief, people. Okay, it's you. Sometimes you watch some, just you put your disbelief to the side and just let it happen. It deals with professional cellists, as you know. Yeah, it's all about professional cellists.
I did not get that from the trailer.
Yeah,
at all.
It's about professional cellists, and cello is just such a great. I would love to be able to play cello. Yeah. So haunting.
I have a friend who is just phenomenal.
It just breathes. It has this. It hits you right in the stomach.
Yes.
And so this movie does have some amazing music in it. Some of the cello in this is really, really good. And so it's about a woman who was, like, about to become the top-tier cellist in the world and then had to stop because her mother became sick.
She's going to be the world's first chair.
World's first chair of the planet. Just sitting on top of the
first
world.
First cello chair.
Drinking a limoncello. And so
delicious.
She has to quit being a professional cellist to take care of her sick mother.
Aww.
And so now there's a new cellist coming up who is now the top chair. And so she goes to meet her and stuff ensues from there.
Oh.
and it has a really good mix. There is some definite body horror.
Oh, there is some, there's some really big-time
body horror.
So
in some
body
scenes.
Horror is like explicitly done torture or some kind of like mutilation, right?
It's that or also just things in your body.
Yeah, like things crawling.
Things in your body and eyeball things.
Decomposition grossness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a trigger warning.
Yeah, so it has a few scenes of some real intense body horror.
Don't sit down with a meal.
Yeah, yeah. Don't sit there and open up some Taco Bell and dig into this movie. Especially about 30 minutes in.
Thank you for that, by the way.
Yeah,
Angela.
Yeah.
It's got some great suspense in it. There's a few scenes that just you feel uncomfortable, where you're like on the edge of your seat, but not in suspense, just cringing, uncomfortable, like
wanting
worried
to vomit.
About. Yeah, not necessarily that. Just like, where is this going to end up? Just where you feel the tenseness of the scene. And so it's a good suspense movie. It has some good revenge elements, which is always fun in a movie, and a few nice little plot twists. And the one big issue is the final scene is unnecessary and doesn't need to be there. It's just unnecessary, and it has way too many questions. Like, you know, if it takes your willing suspension to disbelief and goes, really tests it. You're like, okay, that couldn't have happened. That's too far. And so the final scene just goes that one step too far that kind of takes you out of it. But it is a fun movie if you're into horror, if you're into suspense things. Mm-hmm. It's not like fun, like, wee! It's more like, ah! If that's your, that's my version of fun.
If your escapism is to be like completely disturbed,
yeah.
This is for you.
Yeah, it's up there. And so it's got good pacing. The music is really nice. It's got some a few moments of really good gore.
Is it classical music that they rely on the most? Okay,
yeah.
This is the perfection on Netflix.
Yes, yeah, a lot of good cello music. It's all about cello. When it comes to beard pulls, I'd give it, I think, a 5.5, and because. It impressed me. I liked it more than I thought I would. From watching the previews and knowing what it was about, I was like, okay, I'll give this a try. But as it went on, I was like, I'm liking this a lot more than I thought, you know? And so I really enjoyed that aspect of it, that it goes a little bit farther. Because trailers are so hard to do and how to, you know, to not give away too much. Like, I'm not trying to give it too much away in this review. But if you're into horror, suspense, kind of a good psychological element to it. It's got a good mix of all of those genres of the horror field, you know, and it ties them together fairly well. Good performances. None of the performances really take you too out of it. And so I'd say about 5.5 Man Eddie Beard Pulls for the perfection on Netflix.
That's pretty good.
And, you know, there are some trigger warnings when it comes to rape. There is
good to know for people.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so it is a very disturbing movie. Female-led cast, once again,
Nice.
But because of that, you're going to get into certain, you know, aspects.
And speaking of the cast, Allison Williams, isn't that correct?
Yes.
And that is Brian Williams' daughter?
Is it?
Brian Williams, To Catch a Predator, Brian Williams, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
She was also in Get Out.
Get Out,
yep.
And
yep,
she was in Girls. The show Girls on HBO.
And she was, wasn't she also in The League?
I think she was in League, yeah. And she also, when they did a live showing of Peter Pan, she played Peter Pan.
Oh my God,
that was,
really?
Oh, really?
That was her. Because her dad's this newscaster, and I would always think that she would pick very safe choices, and she doesn't.
Oh, not at
she
all.
She makes very random choices, but I respect her for that.
I have no bug or no desire to act at all. But sometimes friends of mine will say, can you act in my production? And I always say, sure, you got it. Thinking in my mind, they know I'm not an actor. But then, like, it's like, but like, imagine being in that world, and I can't even imagine. And, you know, Carlos Navarro of The Monsters, he's in The Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt, Walking Dead.
Bloodline. He was in Bloodline. He was great in Bloodline.
He's in Red Dead Redemption 2, for crying out loud. It's amazing how many projects you have to sign NDAs, like non-disclosure.
You can't even talk about
agreements.
Yeah.
That's insane. So
yeah. Gwyneth Paltrow didn't realize she was in Spider-Man.
Right. That's insane.
I watched that this weekend. She totally did not remember she was in Spider-Man.
Oh, Gwyneth Paltrow. Well, enough of Gwyneth Paltrow. I think she gets enough hits
there is
on
enough.
Her social
Thank
media.
You.
Yeah,
Thank
you. You know, she's doing well for herself.
She's scooping it.
Oh, man. It's so strange. Anyway, what can we check out, Man Daddy?
Well, this is the checkout. This is the part of the show where we tell you things that we're checking out. We kind of want you to check them out. Fritz, what do you want the people to check out?
The Pulse tragedy happened just 2 days ago on June 12th, 2016. So we are now at the 3 year reflection mark. And I want you to check out all of the bands that we have been playing for rejoins and outros for every segment. LGBTQ friendly bands. And it's very, very easy to be an ally to the Gay Alliance. All you have to do is reach out however you would like to help out, whether it be a monetary donation or just going to an LGBTQ-friendly show and donating your time. So all of the bands that we played tonight, like The Replacements, now more than ever, I think every Central Floridian should stand up and say, enough is enough, enough of the hate. No one needs to die because of what they believe in, especially when it comes to love.
That's amazing.
Nice. Angela, what would you like us to check out?
You know, I mentioned last week that I was going to see Florence and the Machine.
Word.
Yeah, Floma.
She was amazing. And kind of going off of what Fritz just said, her first song that she came out, she started playing the song June. And one of the lines that keeps being repeated in that song is hold on to each other. And when that song started playing, we were up in like one of the...
That's hard, man. That's a beautiful thing to
hold
think
on
about.
To each other. And there was a shirt that was the merch.
And it was called June.
Yes, right. Well, I wish I had looked into it, and I actually wish I had looked into it before even speaking right now, but I was... I didn't know if that song had anything to do with Pulse or was somehow related to it, but when that song started, I realized, because we were up in like one of like the nosebleed sections during the show, and like the first like 10 rows, it seemed, all had pride flags out immediately.
Wow.
Nice. And it was beautiful to see with them like kind of backlit from the stage.
June is the pride month.
It is. And I mean, as soon as she came out, I mean, every time she spoke, which when she's singing, she's like this like pixie fire goddess, amazing, dancing around barefoot
woman
with this
warrior,
wild.
I
she's
think.
A woman warrior. Yep. And she's wearing this like flowy dress and she's barefoot and amazing. And then when she speaks, she's very like, oh, thank you so much for being here. And you're like, you can sing like crazy lady. And like, and the whole time she was so supportive. And she actually had the ACLU at the show.
Oh, God bless
her. If anyone
her.
Needed
Jesus.
To go, she was like, for any new songs you don't really like, if you want to leave and just go talk to them, if anything you're going through, like, please go out there. Mm. And multiple times throughout the show, someone from the audience would throw up this big pride flag and she would dance around with it. And she just had this amazing support and strength. And however you may feel about her music, I feel like you should really check it out. And maybe if you've never considered listening to her, to please listen to her, because she's an incredible artist.
What would you like us to check out this week, man daddy?
Well, first of all, please come out and check out my trivia. I do trivia. I would love to see some people. This is a slow time of year, so I could use some new trivia people.
So, man daddy's trivia is amazing.
Oh, thank you.
It's hard as hell to.
Not always.
Not always,
yeah.
But well, you're so.
That's just gonna make me believe.
You're so fun.
It's so great. Easy.
I can't.
I'm easy.
I can't say that enough. Like, you're a great trivia host.
He's a beautiful human being.
Yeah,
but thank you. I do trivia first and third Mondays at 7 o'clock at Orlando Brewing.
Yeah,
I do it at Lucky's Market in Vineland on Tuesdays from
What's
five
up?
To seven. And the one that I'd really love to see people at Cheers Altamont.
Yeah,
Cheers Altamont on Thursdays at 7.
Yeah,
Thursday at 7. Cheers
that's
Altamont.
The best.
Great drink specials. A $30 gift certificate for first place. It's a lot of fun. And also, there's a video game that I'm playing right now that is very interesting called What Remains of Edith Finch.
Ooh.
And it's not a game. It's a story. It's in a story, and you're not even making decisions. You're just experiencing a life, and it's a woman, a 20-year-old woman, who goes back to try to figure out why her family is so messed up, and she goes to her old house and finds diaries. Whenever she opens up a diary, you become that person, and you experience that person's life or what happened.
Ooh,
and so it's just a it's just a story that you get to experience. It's on Xbox Marketplace, Xbox Game Pass. I think it's on PlayStation 4 Network as well.
It should be.
It's called What Remains of Edith Finch. Very interesting. New type of storytelling for video games. I highly recommend it.
Man, Daddy, you know, in light of us turning over a leaf, how about that? Instead of kicking everyone out, Have them all come in. Have them all spend the night. Come on in.
All right, everybody, open the doors. Open the doors. Okay, open the doors.
All right.
Let in the floodgates. Let in the thousands and thousands of Fort Fritz fans. Come on in, people.
Yes,
come on
so
in. Have
many.
A seat. Get comfortable. Grab some gravy water. Well, we got plenty of gravy water for everybody. Drink it down. It's good for you.
Hey, wait, that guy's got a gun.
No, it was a squirt gun filled with gravy water.
He's doing shots there as well. That's really nice.
Thank you, buddy.
See?
That's all it takes. But this is Fort Fritz. We love you. We thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for participating. Share it. Tell people about it. Keep on listening to Orlando, Florida's Fort Fritz on Real Radio 104.1.
We miss you, Kaz.
Until next time, pleasant dreams.